With the availability of technology like 3D scanning, 3D modeling in CAD, as well as 3D printing, it's never been easier to build high quality cars. We're here with Connor from Butter Welding to talk about this amazing 69 Datsun Roadster. Now, Connor, for a start, why the Datsun Roadster? Why did you sort of gravitate towards this as a project?
Well, it really shows off all the fabrication style that I wanted to show off, as well as my fiance really likes the car too. So it was a good reason to spend a lot of hours in the garage building it for both of us.
It's definitely something different, a bit of a standout. You're not going to see too many of them around. Now, I want to sort of talk about how you've been leveraging technology in this build. So start at the start. What was the car when you first got it and what were the first steps?
Yeah, so the first thing I got was, or first thing I did was 3D scan the bottom of the car, built a custom chassis for it. It's a kind of body on frame car to start with. So I really wanted to build a whole chassis from scratch. All the suspension was built from scratch. So yeah, first step was 3D scanning it and months of CAD work.
Let's just talk about the original chassis. So these days, monocoques are sort of the norm for road cars. We don't sort of see a body on chassis. Older cars, it was the norm, and actually gives us a lot more flexibility when we want to start doing custom fabrication. In terms of problems with that original chassis, what were you trying to fix with your custom chassis?
Yeah, so the original chassis is got some weird front suspension on it that kind of points back. You can't really get a good stance or good performance out of it, as well as factory rear leaf springs. And it just takes so much work to modify the chassis to really fix all that stuff to get it to drive like a good modern car, be able to have fun with it, as well as just looks and showing off fabrication skills a little bit.
I think it's probably easy enough for most people to understand that suspension technology wasn't where it is today back in 1960. So suffice to say, there's a few gremlins that you can iron out. So with the 3D scanning, how critical is that for you to be able to fabricate a new chassis? So how were you leveraging that technology specifically rather than sort of doing it by the old trial and error method?
Yeah, I mean, with the 3D scanner, the car would not have come together. Just the speed of being able to scan and design instead of taking all those measurements and I guess just prototyping multiple parts before you get it right is the big help.
So in other words, being able to sort of make sure that you can cycle the suspension through its travel, steering lock, etc., make sure you're not actually having parts foul on each other?
Yeah, that, and even body clearance with just motion links and parts of the body you wouldn't even think to measure that the chassis would run into, which I missed some of that, but...
Nothing's ever perfect, right?
Yeah.
Okay, once you actually had the chassis fabricated, in terms of the changes to the suspension, I mean, it's pretty clear you've gone with a sort of a rocker suspension setup. What drove that decision? Is it sort of the aesthetics of it? Obviously, it's a show car as well. Was it from necessity for packaging reasons or all of the above?
Yeah, originally I wasn't going to run the rocker arm setup. I was just going to try to package shocks in it. But in CAD, I was just adding all that stuff up, setting up motion links, and it wasn't really working out with fitting exhaust to the rear. And in the front, it was really tight too. So these things have a really cool rear package tray to show off the cantilever setup. And also in the engine bay, I had a really good spot. So kind of just added those in there and made everything work in between.
It looks particularly in the rear like that parcel tray is just begging for that suspension setup. So fair play. And in terms of the design of that rocker arm, depending how you design it, you can sort of build in a different ratio to it. Are you using that to your benefit as well?
Yep. So I knew the shock travel I had. I knew how much wheel travel I had. So I was able to kind of figure out the ratio that way, as well as depending where the different points are, you can get a progressive or digressive setup with it. So I knew I really wanted that progressive setup. So it kind of builds in a bump stop as it goes through.
So with that progressive setup, essentially what you're saying is as the suspension moves into bump travel, the spring rate essentially, or the wheel rate, becomes progressively higher. So you can have a relatively soft, supple ride at ride height, but it's not going to bottom out.
Correct. Yep.
When you're looking at making these rocker arms, I know we talked off camera before about the fact that you actually CNC machined these as well. So talk us through again how you're leveraging CAD and 3D printing and CNC machining to make those.
Yeah, so I mean, you could fabricate them, but that would be pretty difficult with welding. Welding moves everything around. So being able to 3D print and CNC machine really helps keep the tolerances everything and make it all exactly how you draw it.
With the 3D printing, I'm assuming here you're using this as a relatively cheap and quick way to prototype the part, fit it into place, make sure that it actually works before you commit to machining it out of aluminium.
Yep, correct. And just to check the tolerances, and 3D scanning isn't always perfect with bolt holes. So that makes a big difference with 3D printing too, just to be able to actually put the part on and adjust any bolt holes or slop tolerances or anything like that.
That's a really good point actually there. I think people who haven't been involved with 3D scanning probably think it's doing more than it actually is. But essentially, there's still a lot of work in the back end for actually defining the hole sizes, making sure that they're accurate, the distance between holes, etc. That all has to be done in CAD, correct?
Yep, correct. I kind of describe 3D scan as more of a 3D picture than anything. You can put your hand through it, but you kind of just have to use it as a reference for your actual modeling. It's not an actual body.
Helpful to a point, but you still have to actually create entities in CAD that you can then work from. So it's not sort of this click a button and it's done job, is it?
Yeah, that's for sure. It's easier to screw something up if you just go off of a 3D scan.
Now, another part that I wanted to talk about, I saw that's custom on the car, is the adapter between the Nissan VVL cylinder head and, in this case, Weber carburetors, which I guess is a throwback to the age of the car. So talk to us about how you went about developing that part.
Yeah, so I actually 3D scanned the full head, and that kind of got me my bolt centers and then the intake size too, or the shape of the intake port. And then on grad cab, I was able to find models of the Weber carburetors. They were 40s, which is the same intake flange as a 45. I kind of imported both of those things in and then 3D scanned my engine bay, set the length of the runners and everything like that, and was able to basically match in between all that in CAD, designing intake manifold. I then 3D printed that out, test fitted on the bolt flange, which I had to adjust. So went back, adjusted it, printed it out again, and then I was able to CNC machine that out.
I'm interested, what was the problem you found where it didn't fit that first time, which is exactly why we prototype using 3D printing?
One of the bolts in the 3D scan was not defined enough to really get an accurate location, so I had to adjust that.
But when you're doing a 3D print to test, pretty quick and pretty cheap to make that part and throw it away when you find it's not quite right?
Yep, my brother does it all for me, so it's real easy just to send him a model and then swing by my parents' house the next day and pick one up.
Fair play. One of the standout parts in the engine bay, of course, is the exhaust manifold. And you've gone with an interesting material choice there. So talk us through that.
Yeah, so I just kind of wanted to show off a little bit and do kind of what the old Japanese chopper guys do, which is flame bent titanium. And I really wanted a crazy sounding header. So I tried to pack as much tube in there as I could. I got 16 feet of flame bent titanium with the header. And I'm kind of also interested to see how it holds up through the time, because titanium is not, I guess,
not really designed for an exhaust manifold material.
Yeah, exactly. This is a pretty light use, not like a huge race application. So I have a lot of customers that want titanium exhaust materials, like wastegate dumps and stuff like that. I know it's not the greatest for that. So kind of just a test to see how it all works out, and test for slip fit and individual header flanges as well.
Fair enough. The process that you just talked about, flame bending, can you talk to us a little bit more about what that actually involves? How do you do that, and what sort of finish does that give?
Yeah, so to get the real natural curves, unlike mandrel bending would have, you weld one end of it, you pack it with silica sand, and then you hammer a piece of wood in the other end, and it actually packs it all together, the sand. And that kind of is what keeps the round shape as you heat up the outside and just slowly put pressure on. Barely have to get the titanium red hot, and you're able to slowly kind of work that curve to match a wire form that you make.
Okay, so does this give benefits over mandrel bends? Is it just sort of the natural shape that you're looking for? There's not a performance benefit in doing that? I imagine it sounds like it's pretty time consuming.
Very time consuming, and it doesn't always work out. So you scrap a little bit more tube than you would with mandrel bending. It's just kind of for looks, just to get the real flowy, kind of different compound curves that you couldn't get out of a mandrel bend, and saves a little bit of weld, but just more for looks and doing it in a traditional way.
I think in terms of keeping that material alive in an application it's maybe not ideally suited to as well, I notice you are using a slip joint collector, which sort of allows the pipes to naturally grow and retract as they get hot and cold as well. So hopefully that might stop them from cracking.
Yeah, we'll see. I'm really interested to see how it all goes, but I can always fix some cracks if they come up.
Now, the carburetor obviously dealing with fuel delivery, but we've still got ignition timing to consider. I haven't really seen a dirty old distributor hung off the back of the cylinder head there. So how are you dealing with the ignition side of things?
Yeah, I got a crank sensor, and then I'm running a Haltech Elite 550 in it to run the ignition. I got a Bosch 2x2 coil. It's all running batch fire. And then the Haltech is running the VVL solenoid as well. I went to a single VVL solenoid.
Again, probably for the application, 300 horsepower is not really necessary. It's just a cool cruiser.
Hoping for 150.
I imagine you'll make that pretty easily. Look, great to get a bit of a tour of the car. And if people want to find out more about your fabrication services, how are they best to do so?
Yeah, just follow my Instagram. It's Connor, C-O-N-N-O-R dot butter on Instagram.
Perfect. Thanks for your time.
Awesome. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.